Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Evil Life, the true story of the Calabrian Mafia in Australia, by Clive Small and Tom Gilling, and read by Dino Marnika. I'm going to pull his fucking head off. I'm going to eat him alive. Tell him that he can go get his fucking coffin. Get it fucking ready. Translated July 2008, Australian Federal Police telephone intercept of Francesco Mudaferri telling Pasquale Barbaro of his plans for a colleague he accuses of breaking a deal on ecstasy tablets. If there is fear, there is respect. If there is no fear, there is no respect. From a conversation between two 'Ndrangheta bosses in Australia discussing business. Introduction. For more than a century, the term mafia has been synonymous with Italian organised crime. The word usually refers to the Sicilian La Cosa Nostra, but is also commonly applied to the Neapolitan Camorra in the Naples and Campania region, and the Calabrian 'Ndrangheta in the far south of the country. Although less well known than either of its rivals, the 'Ndrangheta is today considered by many international law enforcement officials to be more powerful, more dangerous, and more wealthy than the other two. It is the 'Ndrangheta that dominates Italian organised crime in Australia. John Dickey, Professor of Italian Studies at the University of London and author of Blood Brotherhoods, The Rise of the Italian Mafias, observes that all three mafias have their foundation in myths of an ancient culture, which heroically and nobly defended itself by forming an entity called the Mafia. The truth, however, is different. According to Dickey, around the mid-19th century, bandits and prisoners in the jails of southern Italy began to organise themselves into secret societies with complex initiation rituals, strict rules, and rigid hierarchies. These organisations began to run the jails from inside and to gain control of territories, exerting influence on authorities through bribery and threats of violence. Over time, their economic power grew and they became a significant force in local politics. The mafias of Sicily and Naples emerged during the 1860s, and the Calabrian Mafia in the mid-1880s. Dickey notes that from the outset, one of the things that distinguished the mafiosi from other gangsters was their sense of history, mythical or not. It provided justification for their existence and their authority. In the early days, the terms Camorra and honoured society were used to describe all three mafias. Camorristi were slum dwellers rather than middle-class hoodlums. The term mafia emerged in the 1860s. According to Dickey, in the dialect of Palermo, the word denoted beauty and self-confidence. Picchiotteria, meaning lads with attitude, was applied to the Calabrian Mafia and to lower-ranking members of the Neapolitan Camorra. The term black hand was a catch-all label for Italian gangsterism in the United States and other countries, and derived from the black hands, bloody daggers, and so on, that mafiosi sometimes drew on their extortion letters. The Calabrian Mafia was often referred to as the evil life. While the Neapolitan Mafia has always been known as the Camorra, it was only in the mid-1950s that the Calabrian Mafia became known as the 'Ndrangheta, meaning manliness or courage. In the 1960s, the name Cosa Nostra, our thing, became the standard term for the Sicilian Mafia. The Australian public remained largely unaware of the existence of the Calabrian Mafia until the 1977 murder of Griffith resident Donald Bruce McKay. The 43-year-old anti-drugs campaigner and Liberal Party activist was shot at least three times with a .22-caliber weapon in the car park of the Griffith Hotel. As a result of the murder and the burgeoning drug trade, the state Labor government set up the New South Wales Royal Commission into Drug Trafficking, 1977-79, led by Justice Philip Woodward. The commission found that McKay had been murdered by the 'Ndrangheta to protect its multi-million dollar cannabis cultivation and distribution operation. More than 30 years later, McKay's body has not been found. Those who ordered his assassination remain free. Some still walk the streets of Griffith today. Justice Woodward was not the first to warn Australian governments and law enforcement agencies of the threat posed by the 'Ndrangheta. More than a decade before McKay was killed, the Victorian government had come under intense political and media pressure after a string of murders and attempted murders of people connected with Melbourne's Queen Victoria Market. These became known as the Victoria Market murders. The government had responded by enlisting John T. Cusack, a district supervisor in the US Bureau of Narcotics, and an expert in Italian organised crime, to help the Victoria Police Homicide Squad investigate the killings. Cusack's was the first major assessment of Italian organised crime in Australia. Cusack's 1964 review was not limited to the Victoria Market murders or to Victoria. It also examined the history and activities of the Calabrian Mafia in other states, particularly Queensland and New South Wales. Cusack's conclusions were blunt and unequivocal. The Calabrian La Onorata Società, the Honoured Society, is well entrenched in Australia. It was engaged in extortion, prostitution, counterfeiting, sly grog, breaking and entering, illegal gambling, and the smuggling of aliens and small arms. If unchecked, it was capable of diversification into all facets of organised crime and legitimate business. To further their legitimate endeavours and cloak their illicit operations, society members will conduct a well-planned programme of ingratiating themselves with people of all walks of life. After making his report to the Victorian government, Cusack was asked by the New South Wales government to continue his study of the 'Ndrangheta in that state. The conclusions he reached were similar. Cusack was not the only foreign expert to be called in by the Victoria Police. Another was Dr. Ugo Mazzera, an officer in the Italian police force. Asked for his assessment of the Italian crime problem, Mazzera concluded, like Cusack, that there was no doubt the Victoria Market murders originated from mafia-type criminal activity in Victoria. Unlike Cusack, Mazzera considered that the organisation was of a limited size, involving only a few unscrupulous individuals. Mazzera noted, however, that his research was hurried. On being advised of Cusack's and Mazzera's findings, the Commonwealth Director General of Security ordered an inquiry to gauge the extent, if any, to which secret organisations such as the Mafia have developed in Australia, and to assess the future threat, if any, to Australia. The inquiry was to examine all available material from Commonwealth and state police sources and relevant Commonwealth departments. Colin Brown of the Australian Security Intelligence Organisation was seconded to the Commonwealth Attorney General's Department and began his inquiry in 1964. The scope of Brown's review was significantly greater, and his report was the most detailed and comprehensive of the three. Brown's report has never been officially released, although it broadly follows Cusack's analysis, which refers to serious crimes that were widely reported at the time. Portions of the report have been published, and his work has been cited in police records and reports, court records, newspapers, books, and other documents dealing with crime and the growth of the 'Ndrangheta in Australia. In his report, The Italian Criminal Society in Australia, Brown agreed with Cusack rather than Mazzera. Like Cusack, Brown found that a Calabrian organisation known as La Onorata Società, or the 'Ndrangheta, existed in Australia and was involved in a range of serious criminal activities, including murder, bombing, extortion, immigration rackets, and corruption. The organisation, he said, had been successful in soliciting the support of members of various Australian parliaments and was actively recruiting members living in Calabria to migrate to Australia. The report claimed there was considerable evidence that there was a secret criminal organisation operating within Australia believed to be Calabrian rather than Sicilian or Neapolitan, and loosely organised but rigidly controlled under the traditional system. It appeared to be autonomous within Australia and not controlled from Calabria, although it was dependent upon Calabria for its new recruits. Brown found that the 'Ndrangheta was expanding in New South Wales, including the Australian Capital Territory, Victoria, and South Australia, and had ambitions to grow in Queensland and Western Australia. Among the cells operating in New South Wales, Brown drew particular attention to the reported existence of an active branch at Griffith. At least 200 people in the area were suspected of association with the 'Ndrangheta. Both Cusack and Brown were unambiguous. A secret Calabrian criminal organisation had been active and growing in Australia for more than 40 years and continued to grow. To counter the threat, Brown recommended a more intensive and comprehensive law enforcement approach, the removal of immigration loopholes, and a restriction on undesirable migrants, particularly those reasonably believed to be associated with Italian criminal organisations. Deportation for immigrants reasonably believed to be members of the 'Ndrangheta. Greater awareness of the problem and the threat posed, and better coordination among all government departments involved. These warnings and recommendations were largely ignored. 4 years after the Brown Report, the Canberra-based Central Crime Intelligence Bureau, CCIB, prepared a national assessment of Italian criminal society in Australia. It named 341 people who had migrated from Calabria to Australia and were suspected of being 'Ndrangheta members. Most had entered Australia through Sydney and Melbourne between the mid-1930s and the early 1960s and had settled in New South Wales, Victoria, and South Australia. A few had settled in Western Australia and Queensland. The thought of Italian organised crime existing in Australia excited the media, but made politicians uncomfortable. Half a century of migration had made Italian Australians a constituency worth courting. In a memo headed 18th of July 1972, La Fiamma, Sydney, the soon-to-be Prime Minister Gough Whitlam wrote, "I have only contempt for those Australian politicians and journalists who have attempted to smear the Italian community and their clubs in the latest sensation-mongering about the so-called mafia. The stories and comments have generally shown profound ignorance and prejudice. In Australia, crime and corruption of all kinds are overwhelmingly confined to the Australian-born." In denying the existence of the mafia in Australia, Whitlam was, wittingly or unwittingly, rehearsing a formula that was as old as Italian immigration to Australia. In April 1934, at the height of the violence in the Queensland cane fields, the Italian consul S. Tanfani told the Courier-Mail that there was no Black Hand Society. It had been wiped out. There was, of course, the mafia, which once operated in Sicily, but which had been destroyed by a police commissioner specifically appointed for that purpose. Political sensitivities in Australia mirrored those in Italy itself. In 1932, Smith's Weekly had noted that in response to Australian newspaper reports about Camorra vendettas, the Italian Consul General, Commendatore Gossardi, in a passionate speech on April 21, threatened that he would...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.